Tuesday morning, and this is where the conversations will start from. Everywhere else is literally muted. That's why the GJA at 70 says TV3 New Day is the morning show of the year, and you know that the GJA cannot get it wrong. Anyway, the Finder newspaper, e-visa start in 2020 to boost Ghana's tourism sector. Dr. Bomia, licensed cocoa buying company sue GRA cocoa board over VAT. ADB to partner POSCO International to establish oil palm refinery. And BOG, Bank of Ghana, keeps the policy rate at 16%, fifth time running. Somebody would ask, so why aren't we seeing it in our lending rates? Daily Guide, licensed cocoa buying to GRA. Ex-Maxlock boss took 500,000 Ghana cedis in a bag, according to a witness. And let's tap into tourism, Vice President Bomia. Ghana, 528 million Ghana cedis to tackle flooding. That's what we're being told. The Council of Foot of Lawyer Atacha is the Member of Parliament for Abuakwa and also the Minister in Charge of Works and Housing. The Ghanaian Times, ADB to partner POSCO International to establish oil palm refinery. Majority-minority remain divided over December 17 referendum. And government completes recruitment of 120 nurses for Barbados. 13 LBCS drag GRA cocoa board to court over proposed VAT charges on tracking and haulage. And finally, the Daily Graphic. Citizens join referendum debate, ignorance, apathy, mistrust, rare heads. And also, dream comes true as Olivia is now a medical doctor from zero to hero. And Bank of Ghana to check compensation of bank CEOs. The back page, halt incursion of fishermen into offshore safety zone. That's a big one. And drone spraying of farm tested in Etiwa East District. My guest this morning, the Honourable Roxin Nelson, the Fiamakpa, the Member of Parliament for North Danyi, South Danyi, in the Volta region is here. Andre Japamesa will join me shortly. He's on the touchline. He is the Member of Parliament for the 2nd D constituency. So we will start the conversation with you, Council. Yesterday, your party held a press conference asking for the head of Mr. Yao Safumafu, especially the matter of Iyoko versus the Auditor General. And you say he should be arrested ASAP and sent home. Why are you causing trouble, as someone said yesterday?
Let me customarily seize the opportunity to say good morning to my constituents in South Danyi, Peki, Kwali, Kwebe, Tongo. And urge all the citizens of Peki to attend this year's Bidu Kosa in Peki in a couple of weeks' time. Now, my brother, it's a very simple matter. It's on record that the senior minister's outfit actually masterminded the payment of over $1 million dollars to Crow Associates, a UK-based company, to ostensibly undertake some forensic audit of certain government institutions in this country. Now, according to the Auditor General's annual report, his outfit discovered that even though this money has indeed been paid, no work had been done. And you know, the Auditor General's report doesn't simply come out. It goes through a process. And according to his office, they went through the rudiments of preparing the report and eventually had to lay the final report before Parliament. Now, it is what has come before Parliament that we are interrogating. And so when the issue broke, the senior minister's outfit now rise to the Auditor General, trying to explain away the circumstances surrounding the payment, and to also indicate that indeed some work had been done, and to further also say that indeed he had the green light from the national security outfit in order to
go ahead
with the contract with these people. But the Auditor General insists that, well, per my records, you still have to refund the money. Mm-hmm. So that's where we are. And then out of the blue, it has emerged that the Auditor General's outfit is rather being investigated by IOCO. He's taking the matter to court. So I would, as we say, you know, the matter is sub judice. So I won't touch on the merits of that. So we in the NDC are of the opinion, and firmly so, that it is rather the senior minister who ought to be investigated. In addition to having been called upon by the Office of the Auditor General to refund that money and also surcharged, he should also be investigated. So if there is any person whose outfit has to be investigated, it is that of the senior minister.
So some say this has become political football because 1 year, the MPP had an issue with the appointment of Mr. Tumelovo in the early days of their government. Mm. Subsequently, he would be the same person who would lead the charge to run an audit of road projects and all of that, and all of that. Now, somebody will say you are playing political football because you are looking for equalization. So once Mr. Tumelovo is being dragged in to the IOCO, you are also looking for a way to drag Mr. Osafomafo in. What do you say to that?
It has no basis at all. If anybody makes that such a comment, it has no basis. Why? We are simply saying that this government championed the creation of the Office of the Special Prosecutor.
Right.
And we specifically mandated the Office of the Special Prosecutor to look into corruption and corruption-related matters. Mm. And so if there are any issues about procurement breaches, which invariably will have something to do with corruption or corruption related, it has to be the Office of the Special Prosecutor that should take this up. I am not saying
The office is not functional.
Is the office not functional? When in this year's budgetary allocation they had as much as 188 million Ghana cedis allocated to its office to function.
They had 180 in the previous one.
No, this year.
Yes, and I'm saying the allocation was in the previous one. And Mr. Amidu, we just heard him say that, look, he doesn't even have the power to
procure. The office was formally, if I say officially established in 2018.
Okay.
And so in the 2019 budget allocation, he was allocated as much as 188 million.
Absolutely.
The year is about to end.
He said he doesn't have money. I
have no idea.
But he's been saying it. Mr. Amidu has been saying
it. No, I haven't heard
him say it. He doesn't have money. He doesn't have a procurement officer to help him get things. So
you see,
he's more like working with a new close team
own. You know the problem I have?
What is your problem?
The problem I have is that the special prosecutor thinks that he is the office. He is not the office of the special prosecutor. He's only the special prosecutor. Mm. The office is a structure we have crafted.
Okay.
He's even supposed to have regional offices. Mm. He's supposed to have even district offices. Mm-hmm. So what is preventing him from setting up the infrastructure necessary for the effective functioning of his outfit? You can't, look, as a single individual, you can't do this alone. We have crafted an outfit for you. The board has been established. So what is this business of I'm not receiving the cooperation of the other investigative bodies? Right. In any case, in the law, we set it up in such a way that until you become fully fledged, other investigative bodies are supposed to help you investigate matters anyway.
Right.
So I have a big problem about the persistent complaint that he's making.
I think he's talking
too much. He has a deputy. He's supposed to have a deputy. The deputy has been appointed. So what has the deputies or the deputy done so far?
Is he talking too much than what he's supposed to be doing?
Because there's so much to be looked into.
Okay, Council, Andre Chapamesa, welcome.
Thank you.
Good to have you.
Relieving me from the touchline.
Bro, you have been substituted.
Good morning to our cherished.
Thank you. Thank you very much for joining us.
Roxy Nelson.
Okay.
Yeah.
And to the people of Sekendi.
Absolutely.
Yeah, sure, absolutely. Yeah. Let's talk about the NDC's call to have your senior minister dealt with according to the law because of the issues that he has raised. Are their concerns legitimate?
Completely baseless. But of course, coming from them is not surprising. Because they've set out right from the 8th of January 2017, the very next day that Akufo-Addo came into government to sink corruption. One day in government. That's when they started. And you heard them through the bond issuance that they still have not returned from the Securities and Exchange Commission in America. To date, Mr. Okudjeta Black was petitioned to SEC. He hasn't still come back. Through cash for seat and now Honorable Osafumafu. Of course, the Auditor General did his work and he found some issues. Including issues with the procurement of the contract with Kroll. And one of the interesting things that I got to learn was that he says that the actual work commenced in February when the contract was executed in August. And so that in itself is wrongful. But thankfully, I have a lawyer colleague who is a member of the NDC on this panel. And he can tell us all whether it is unusual for a contract to be executed that has an effective date in the past. He can tell us. And so that basis itself is untenable.
They said there was no work done and yet you paid.
But you see, the Honorable Osafumafu has detailed out the exact role that Crow played and indeed indicated that the contract that was executed with Crow is a 4-year contract. So how can you conclude? But I'm saying that he's done his job.
Okay.
And it is for the auditee to provide responses.
Right.
And if he is dissatisfied with the outcome of the findings of the Auditor General, go to the appropriate forum to seek relief. And that's exactly what my understanding is that Mr. Osafumafu is doing. So where in the call from the NDC that he should be sanctioned? Investigated for what?
What should happen instead?
The due process ought to be carried through. If indeed the court finds Mr. Osafumafu or the surcharge that the Auditor General to have made to be legitimate, let the court make a pronouncement. That's due process.
What do you say to the fact that the Auditor General has been witch hunted with Iyoko so that it keeps him busy there not to be able to look into issues of corruption that are happening in your government?
Baseless allegation. And I've heard them suggest that this government intends to remove the Auditor General.
Let him
tell the people of Ghana whether the process for removing the Auditor General of this country lies with Yoko. Let them tell us. We know the process. Somebody has to petition the president for the president to refer the petition to the Supreme, the Chief Justice. Is that what is happening? Now, interestingly, if the Auditor General finds the contract that was executed by Honorable Osafumafu to be faulty, how is a procurement process that he supervised being found faulty tantamount to witch hunt? I'm an ardent believer in due process. And so if people trigger an activity that is in accordance with rules and procedure, you may be unhappy, you may be dissatisfied. But that's the rules. And so I expect, I as the Auditor General has done, to go to court and challenge the mandate of Yoko in investigating him in respect of that matter.
So you see, there's no cause legit- for alarm.
Where is the cause for alarm? Where is it? But consistent with their populist nature, raise issues, offer no iota of proof, and invite everybody to debate it. That's what they do. Or you don't know them. Huh? That's their pension.
Every member in the NDC does that?
Oh, I'm talking the NDC as a political party that their general secretary
okay.
held a press conference yesterday. Is that not what we are discussing?
Yeah.
So please, I've challenged them. What Ghanaians want to hear is what alternative they have to the budget that all experts who have spoken to, at least at the post-budget conference that we held, at which he was present. In fact, we had lunch together on the first day. to espousing the good work that this government has done in the past 3 years. The path that this government has put the economy of this country on. It was good that His Excellency, the Otumfo in it, Otumfo said to two. Indicated that the economy is going to be the focus of election 2020.
Right.
And this government has done, of course, there are issues.
We'll come to that.
That is what the people of Ghana want to hear from them.
Take a minute to rebuttal and they will get 1 minute as well.
First of all, you recall that they said when they get into government, they'll remove the Malevo.
Right.
You know that. They were not happy about his appointment. You recall that they said that they were not happy about the appointment of the EC chair, Charlotte Ose, and that they will get her out. Mm. Now, they have succeeded in getting Charlotte out. Clearly. And that's the evidence.
Maybe it was easier to do that.
It was not easier. It's the same, if you look at the constitutional stipulations, it's a similar procedure. It's very difficult. But they succeeded. By any means necessary. Petitions that were not signed were rectified and proceeded upon. And today, the rest, is they say, is history. So we are letting the good people of this country, that they appear to be adopting the same method against the Auditor General. And so all should watch it. Why? My brother is correct by saying that it is up to the Honorable Safu Manfu to go to court to seek to torpedo the findings, the adverse findings against him in the auditor's report.
Right.
That's correct. It's also correct in saying that the Auditor General has proceeded to court to indeed challenge the mandate of Yoko to deal with him. But beyond all that, what we are asking them to do is to inquire into this matter.
Okay.
That under what circumstances did the office of the senior minister award this contract? A contract. I agree that as an entity you can award a contract, you know, and ratify its ratification. You did something back in time. And so the effect can be ratified. It's called ratification in law.
Retrospectively.
Yes. But we are saying that when they say the work has been done, where is the report? The man has not been able to provide any report.
He said now, Osafo Mafo has shown
now
you.
Now, is the Ministry of National Security, the supervisory ministry of the minister, of the senior minister's ministry? You know, this matter also came up. Mm-hmm. And cleverly, they collapsed his ministry and moved it under the office of the president. That's what they did. So now, he says that in order to procure services of an entity, he needed authorization from national security. Is that the kind of architecture we are creating?
Okay.
So he can seek to bastardize the NDC. He can seek to say all manner of things about the NDC. We are impervious to that. We are telling them that they appear to be adopting the same approach against the Auditor General. And now we'll ask the matter of the budget and their economic policy. We shall interrogate it.
We'll get into it.
But take a second
on this one.
It's unfortunate that we tend to play politics with everything. Of course, at the time that Mr. Mahama appointed Mr. Dumelewo, when he had lost roundly the 2016 general election. You think it was fair?
Somebody says.
In any event, yes, he had a right. No problem. No. I don't have a problem. No.
Really?
But Mr. Dumelewo has been in office through 2017, through 2018, and he's still in office. I asked, and he conveniently, or maybe he didn't avert his mind to that the question that I posed, whether the process for removing the Auditor General lies with Yoko.
And he says that.
So if somebody has brought a petition to Yoko that, look, as far as I'm concerned, a certain process was not done properly, and so investigate. It is entirely possible that the person who even submitted the petition is not aware that Yoko is not the appropriate.
He says that in the matter of the former EC Charlotte Osei, a similar process was adopted to pick her out.
We were not in this country. We're not in this country when we heard the accusations and counter accusations from the commissioners of the Electoral Commission. Mm. It was MPP which instigated them to do that.
Yes, you did all.
We're not in this country.
You did all.
When Amadou Sule and Co.
You did all that.
Oh, it was MPP instigated.
Yes, you did all that.
How did, really? How did they do that?
To cook the grounds.
Really? How did they do
to cook the grounds. How to prepare the grounds.
You got Amadou Sule and told them, go and speak small.
Accuse Charlotte Osei.
You did all that.
And MPP asked Charlotte Osei to put that, out counter accusations against his own commissioners.
To create the atmosphere. To create that atmosphere.
I didn't know the MPP was this
powerful. I hear you. 0202166633. The MPP is quite powerful. According to Roxin Nelson.
Her own colleagues to get for her colleagues to accuse her.
To get
such that all of them were removed.
Uttered.
MPP got them to against themselves.
The president. You know the president said that he was only a conveyor belt. Of that petition.
Okay, let me move
on. Other petitions are resting at the presidency. Someone he won't convince.
Let's
them.
Move on. Let's go to Otumfuo's palace. And His Royal Majesty has said that, you know, you will be judged by Ghanaians according to what the economy is showing. We're reading on the front page of the tabloids that the Bank of Ghana has kept the policy rate at the same, you know, point, about 16%. 15 to 18% for the fifth time running. So that's supposed to have an impact on the economy. But the big question that people are asking are that, well, so if the policy rate is stable, how does that translate to lending rates? Because the president has appealed to the bankers to bring it down. Mm. The vice president has appealed to them to bring it down. They are keeping it there, obviously, because they have certain conditionalities and things in there. How do we marry the two? Because in your books, we are fine. On the ground, the people say the economy is not pocket friendly. And Otumfuo says, we won't judge you by free SHS, we will judge you by the economy.
And that statement itself has been twisted by our friends in the NDC. You recall Mr. Mahama indicating, yes.
The NDC now write that.
Hold on. I said the statement by Otumfuo has been twisted.
How so?
Yes, because now Otumfuo spoke in context. He made reference to the excellent outcomes of the free SHS.
Right.
And that it was indeed a bold policy that no government, has been able to do amongst our peers. Mm. But beyond that, when the chips fall, it's the economy. And so indicated to government that, yes, what it is that you are doing.
Okay.
You recall that he had indicated to His Excellency the President to remain focused on what he's doing.
Okay, so let me share a bit of what His Royal Majesty Otumfuo says. He says, we have been courageous in providing free senior high school or secondary education for all. Few countries can claim such valiant effort.
Absolutely.
But when the chips are down, it is the economy our people are going to judge us
by. Of course.
It is what happens in the market, what jobs we create, what infrastructure we provide that will play on our minds. And it's all about the economy. So there cannot be any more important institutions than those holding the levers of the economy. The Bank of Ghana and the commercial banks, the Revenue Authority, the Allied Revenue Generation Agencies, the private sector enterprises, and institutions like the Association of Ghana Industries, the Chamber of Commerce, the Chamber of Mines, among others, the Asantini said in a lecture at the University of Professional Studies in Accra. So that's what the His Royal Majesty
said. So it was purely in context.
Right.
And I'm saying that I agree with him entirely. And this government agrees with him. That's why over the past 3 years, we focused at fixing the economic fundamentals, okay, at the macro level. Because if you don't fix the macro economy, it will not translate into the micro.
How long do we have to wait?
It takes some short, medium term, some even long term.
3 years.
Okay. 3 years, 5 years, okay? That's why the standard measure, okay, is to give government 8 years,
okay,
within which the expectation will be that issues at the macro level would have been fixed to translate to the micro level. And look, you see, I've heard our colleagues say that when we were in opposition, we said that Dr. Baumia touted the weak economic fundamentals and all that.
The fundamentals are weak. Absolutely. The exchange rate will expose you.
Of course. Is it not true?
Foundation or straw. I remember that
okay.
as well.
So, question is, they knew the importance of those numbers. Today, they tell us that Ghanaians don't feel it on the street. So I ask myself, if you knew that all these economic macro indicators were not important, why did you go to the IMF for policy credibility? Why? Because we all recognize that to get your micro economy functioning properly, to have a long-term sustainable growth for your people, you need to have the macro economy right.
Right.
You messed it up completely.
And now you're
and it looks over good the on past paper. Absolutely. And so I'm saying that a consistent growth numbers, a consistent macro indication, that's why we passed the Fiscal Responsibility Act.
Right.
So that saddle ourselves with the task of remaining within a certain budgetary constraint in an election year. Okay? This is discipline. This is pure long-term forward-looking economic policy.
In the meantime, statutory funds have been capped. So you are asking me not to overspend and you are giving me less to spend. You are squeezing me on both sides, aren't you?
Nobody is being squeezed on both sides. The rationale for the capping policy was well articulated. Okay? The fact that statutory entities were allocated a certain percentage of the common consolidated fund didn't mean that they needed all of it in one year cycle. And indeed, it was established as a matter of fact that rather than investing in the areas that these funds have been allocated to, they were keeping the monies in banks and earning interest on them. So government had to do a rationalization, okay, of their real needs and cap the amounts that were given to some of these institutions to bring some
What do you say to the counter argument that the NDC makes that, look, you are capping the funds to keep the monies in the accounts, to use them as balance sheets to go and borrow money? What do you say to that?
What balance sheet to go and borrow which money? Let them point out to us, then we can interrogate it. Let them point out the balance sheet that government has kept statutory funds in to leverage same to go and borrow money. Let them show us.
There's nothing
I'm saying that, Johnny, the principle ought always be consistent, except when the exception rule applies.
Okay.
That he who alleges must prove.
Must prove. Maximum
so effect. If you make the allegation, prove it. Don't leave it hanging and ask all of us to spend time to interrogate the allegations that you've made. I'm saying that this government is on track. All the experts attest to it. We are not out of the woods yet. There are issues, and we are going to work on them consistent with our plan. And so if the Bank of Ghana has retained the policy rate at 16%, it all goes to show the kind of assessment that they've made. And it's important
rates are not coming down.
At the time that the policy rate was 24%, lending rate was in the excess of 30-35%.
Right.
Now it's trended downwards to about 20-26, thereabouts.
Which is still on the high
side. Yes, it's still on the high.
Lending rate is 29-30.
Whatever.
It has
trended downwards from the upwards of 35%. Fact.
Okay.
But we are saying that
when
it
was 24.
Anyway, 24 when? It was 24 when?
You just said it was 24. Didn't you just say so? That when it was 24.
When the policy rate was 24%. Yes. And so I'm saying that banks, I've worked in a bank before. I know what goes into the cost of banks.
I know.
Absolutely.
Exchange rate.
So it's not easy for the president or vice president to announce publicly that we have reduced it, so the banks should deal with it.
No, so the expectation
is that there are things that go into calculating it. So when you make a public announcement like that, it doesn't go to suggest that the banks will immediately start bringing
everything. But you see, there's a huge risk premium because of the informal nature of our economy that the banks apply to even their own cost of funds.
Even non-performing loans and all of that.
And all that. And so if all those figures are improving, the expectation will be that the lending rate will also have to trend downwards.
Okay.
It's not responding as quickly as we all expect.
Okay.
And so moral switching is part of banking.
Quickly respond to this one. Otufor, His Royal Majesty also mentioned the markets and job creation. How are we trying to get this in? And yes, I know you talk about NAPCO, you talk about planting for food and jobs and all of that. How about those who are not interested in those and want to start up their own small businesses, SMEs? How do we push them in?
Of course, so everybody's pushing. The National Entrepreneurial Program has supported several young people. NYA is rolling out programs that are supporting people. You see, we ought to view the plan of the MPP in a holistic manner. NAPCO is only an intervention.
Right.
That is intended to say that, look, whilst our long-term plan is to industrialize this country, we are not there yet. It will take time for all the factories that we want the private sector to partner government in rolling out. It will take time. In the interim, there are huge unemployed graduates out there who don't have work experience. So how do we resolve it? Put them in the NAPCO, get them to acquire some work experience so that as the industries roll out, as more and more companies are established, these people who have finished universities would have acquired the requisite skill whilst earning some living allowance and being absorbed into those industries that are springing up.
Thank you.
It can't happen in a day.
Thank
it's
you.
Not an event.
But
it's a process. And I'm saying that this government is on track.
But then the NDC will say, look, you made it look so real and glaring and shiny that the people of Ghana went to the polls to elect you to lead, and now you're telling them it's not as easy as it is. It's a process.
Did you read our manifesto? And did you expect that when we stand on platforms, we would read the manifesto to people? We'll summarize it. We'll give people an indication, bullet point indication of the plan that we have for this country.
Okay.
But if you read our manifesto in detail, nothing was hidden from the good people of this country.
Okay.
Indeed, you have heard our friends say that we promised.
How many people read the party's manifesto?
No, but that's why you can only summarize through some oral presentation as to the key aspects of your manifesto. And I was saying that you've heard them say to Ghanaians that we promised that we're going to build factories across the country.
Was that not what you said?
Where did we say it? When we have an experience with state-owned enterprises, which have all failed. So our plan was clear that in collaboration with the private sector, which we all believe is the... Which of them have, from Kwame Nkrumah's era, we live in this country when the state went to borrow money to build a sugar factory that the next day they closed it for rehabilitation. That is still not being opened to date.
Okay.
What are we talking about?
But you have SIGA now, don't you?
State interest.
Yes.
Yes, of course. The state has interest in some commercial entities and some organizations that
some say it's bad management, which is why you're not able to manage it. So let the private sector.
So where are the state bakeries and the glass factories and all that we established in the 1950s?
Most grateful.
And 60s.
Most grateful for your time. Council, step in for me. So the Otufor has spoken. Andrew says they are in agreement with him. They are on track. The process is on, and you need to take your time to feel the full benefit, because they're working at the macro to get to the micro.
It is only when the MPP is boxed into a corner that they know that contest exists. Today they speak of contest. Today the MPP says that when statements that reflect the true state of affairs are made by very serious opinion leaders in this country. We should place it in context. I thank him.
At least we're not insulting him.
I thank him. Who insulted the two for? That propaganda. Allow for him.
Council.
Look, that was propaganda. Council, make progress.
Make progress.
I'll make progress.
Yes.
But I'm happy that today he says we should place matters in context.
You have a problem with that.
What is the context? Otunfuo is saying that when you design your budget in such a way that about 60% of it goes into consumption, and when we ask you, you point us to free SHS, it will lead you into damnation. The people who want to see what reflects in the true economy of the country. What do we speak of? Road construction subsector of the economy in 2016 grew by 8.7%. 2019, according to their own budget figures, is negative 8.2. So within 3 years, there's a decline of about 16 plus something percent. That's what it means. And yet they will sit here and say, and look, road construction employs, is one of the largest employers of this economy. They employ so many skilled laborers as well, because it's a labor-intensive subsector of the economy.
The government said it will look better in 2020.
How is it? Let me expose that fallacy. Per their own Sino-Hydro agreement, 1 kilometer of asphalt will be constructed at $1.2 million, at the cost of $1.2 million.
Right.
All right? They've listed about 2,288.70 kilometers in their budget statement, table 21
is where the list is for the
critical roads.
Right.
That they will undertake. 2,288. Now, if you compute that, it gives you about $2.3 billion. Where are they going to get the money?
Who says all the roads?
Please. What are you going to do?
So show us.
Hold on. Ejapa. Hold on. You are going to construct, right? You are going to construct a whole bypass.
Right.
You won't do asphalt. Whole dualization, you won't do asphalt. Is that what he's saying?
That's not what I said. I asked you who says all the roads are going to be asphalt.
So Ejapa, tell me which ones will be asphalt.
In any event, who says that
critical roads, you won't do asphalt.
Say it, but
who says so?
Hold on. But you spoke for about 15 minutes. But I was very quiet.
Hold on. So let me get clarity from you.
You were not consistent. Let me get clarity from you now.
So the critical roads, as I've seen, has a reach and spread across the country.
Yes.
And will
be. In fact, every region has at least three.
Okay. Now, so these are very crucial roads. And you say that not all of them will be asphalted.
I asked a simple question. In any event,
because he's raising a question about cost.
Hold on. Where does it say there that these are routes that are going to be under Sino-Hydro?
I didn't say Sino-Hydro.
That's why you use the Sino-Hydro to
say that. I am giving you your Sino-Hydro permutations. What are you saying?
Nelson.
Ejapa, don't do this.
So where does Sino-Hydro respect
Ejapa,
these routes?
Ejapa, I am saying, using your Sino-Hydro computations, and I even suspect that these ones will be higher.
How? We don't know.
No, but I want to use. They are saying that under Sino-Hydro, 1 kilometer will be constructed at the cost of $1.2 million.
Right.
That's what they said. It's part of the agreement they brought down.
But not all the roads are Sino-Hydro.
Exactly. Who says interchange?
Is it saying that it's going to? I didn't calculate interchange.
But that's part of the Sino-Hydro.
Please.
Is that whole bypass? Please. Right? You mentioned whole bypass.
They said under Sino-Hydro. Ejapa. Please, let's do this. Okay, at what cost are you going to construct 1 kilometer stretch of this road?
Do you know?
2,000. He doesn't know. So, and I'm giving you the basis, at least the fundamental calculation.
And so your point is that we can't do it?
We can't do it.
Because we have not allocated enough.
No, they don't have the money. They are not going to get the money.
But we have a road fund.
Road fund. They cap the road fund. They take 600 million cities from the road fund every year. Road fund gets maximum of about 1.2 every year.
Right.
You take half, almost half. What can they do?
No, that's not true.
Please.
Okay.
Ejapa,
I'm told that time is up.
No. The man had about 15
apologies. Apologies. You are my good friend. Apologies.
It's not fair.
Apologies.
It's not fair.
Like, we are all dark. We are all.
And let me deal with the policy rate. You are saying your policy rate is 16%. Mm. Lending rate is about 29-30. He says we should clap for them. Look, in the banking sector cleanup, it's just on the news that the receivers have been able to recover only 1 billion. They are still looking for 9 billion. There's no confidence in the banking sector.
Really?
No confidence.
Even after the cleanup.
I am telling you, people are cooking figures. That's the point. They are suppressing the figures.
You see?
You are suppressing the figures. I'm telling you.
Johnny, people
are not putting their money in the bank.
I need to respond to this.
You won't respond. Because you have said a lot of time, this argument. It's not.
These figures are being cooked.
You are cooking figures.
You are member of the parliament.
You are cooking figures.
And our guest this morning have been the Honorable Andrew Ejapa Mercer. He is the member of parliament for the 2nd D constituency in the Western region. He's on for a second term. And also Roxanne Nelson Dafia Makpo, the member of parliament from the south of Dangi, and he's joined us here. Most grateful for your time, gentlemen. But Bobo is getting an astroturf in his community. Are you getting? Are you getting
to give me one?
No, no. But
I'm lobbying him.
But he doesn't construct the astroturf.
He lobbies. He should lobby one for me.
But so you want one?
I want one for my people, good people of South Dangi.
But so get it.
But I have a lot of youth in Germany. There, I have about 4 football teams in Germany. Yeah. We don't have good training. Yeah.
You see, Johnny.
I bought some good fish at Germany.
Yeah. So I want an astroturf. For my boys, this
argument that train, our friends make,
they can train.
We are spending 60% in consumption,
okay.
Yes, consumption,
and they were investing in economy,
okay. In capital expenditure.
So, question is, how come you were investing in capital economy, okay. Capital expenditure, but your GDP was declining?
Infrastructure, that's what they explained.
So, how come their GDP was declining?
They are now
okay. Thank you very much. Like, that's